Well, good morning. Good morning. I'm very, very glad that you are here this weekend. It's a great week. It's, I think, one of the most unique weeks in all of the year because it's a week where we're looking back to the year that has passed and looking forward to the year it is to come. To look back at 2019, at all of the hardships, at all of the joy, all of the lessons learned. To look back at the faithfulness of God, like we've talked about already, to be thankful, but to also look forward to 2020 with anticipation, excitement, to prayerfully anticipate what is gonna come. I pray that 2020 would be the best year yet. I pray that 2020 would be the year that your daughter is saved. I pray that 2020 would be the year that your sister is healed. The year that your anxiety experiences peace. I pray that it would be the best year yet. And one of my favorite things to do during this week each year is to set goals or to set resolutions that I decide I'm gonna keep for the coming year. I'll never forget being about 12 years old and deciding, you know what? This is the year for me. This is the year I'm gonna get a six pack. I'm gonna master the guitar. I'm gonna read the Bible twice all the way through. I'm gonna win the Super Bowl on my Xbox. I did one of those things, and I'm gonna go ahead and let you decide which one I accomplished. According to a study performed by the University of Scranton, about 8% of people that set their New Year's resolutions keep them. There's an app called Strava. It's a social networking app for athletes. And last year, the app, after analyzing 31.5 million global online activities, the app was able to assess, to analyze when New Year's resolutions, on average, stopped. Any guesses? January the 12th. 12 days. That's 3% of the goal. For reference, if my goal was to watch all 10 seasons of The Office and I stopped 3% of the way, I would barely finish season one and I would assume that Pam and Roy end up together, which essentially ruins the show. If my goal right now was to drink 2.5 gallons of water and I accomplished 3% of that goal, I would drink this bottle of water. If my goal was to travel to New York City and I just left right now, got in the car and started driving and drove 3% of the way there and stopped, I would be standing in Wicker Park. It happens. You start strong. You run twice in the first week. You get a small Portillo shake instead of a large one. You read all the way to Leviticus. Things are going well. And then it's over. It happens. I pray that this year in 2020, this coming year, we could look back and see one thing that we have done together. In 2020, my goal, and hopefully your goal when you leave today, is to be a good servant of Jesus Christ in the coming year. To be a good servant. Today we're going to be looking in our Bibles at 1 Timothy chapter 4, starting in verse 6. 1 Timothy 4, verse 6. Go ahead and turn there. Now, does anybody else really hate it when you come into church and the note sheet is blank? It's okay. Did anybody, when you picked up the note sheet, you're like, oh no, oh no. If you're like my wife, you have a couple of questions at this point. You're like, okay, well, what are the blanks? Like, how many blanks are there? How many points are there? Is there a list that's coming up that I need to leave space for in between? How much longer is Heath gonna be talking until I can go? It's okay. All I can say is that you're gonna have to pay attention this morning. We're in 1 Timothy chapter 4, and there the Apostle Paul is giving a charge to young Timothy, who's been a student in Paul's discipleship to Jesus. Paul starts, writes in verse 6, if you put these things before the brothers, you will be a good servant of Christ Jesus, being trained in the words of faith and of the good doctrine that you have followed. These things, in verse 6, is a reference to verses 1 through 5, where Paul is identifying false teaching to Timothy, teaching that is on its own demonic, and it would forbid people from things completely right in the eyes of the Lord. If you have a pen with you, go ahead and underline these things in verse 6, and you can write an arrow, draw an arrow up to verses 1 through 5. That's what it's referring to. Paul charges Timothy and us to know that a good servant speaks the truth. A good servant speaks the truth. Our voices are raised for truth, raised for what is right. Now, if you're looking at the ESV translation of the Bible, the phrase used here is being trained in the words of faith and of good doctrine. This word trained is the Greek word entrepho, and this is actually the only time it is used in the New Testament. A better definition for this word, in my opinion, is to nourish in. The idea that we would be rooted down and receiving life from the words of faith and the good doctrine that we have followed. Now, knowing that, this first point, I believe, becomes a bit heavier. Is anybody else here okay to raise your hand and say, I am very good at speaking my thoughts? If I think something, gates open, I'll speak it. Okay. Is anybody like, okay, I'm pretty good at speaking my feelings. If I feel something, I can talk about it. Okay. Is anybody, you're like me, you're just good at speaking? Like, it doesn't matter to who, when, where. Like, if I'm breathing, I'm speaking. Anybody? Okay. Is anybody sitting next to a person who's like that but doesn't know they're like that? Okay, don't point, but see, we are called to speak up. We are. But the thing that we are charged to say here pertains to truth and doctrine. Think of it like this. This is an avocado pit. My goal, my desire is that this avocado pit would grow more avocados because they're delicious. So the problem with this, there's nothing wrong with it on its own, but the problem is if the goal is to make more avocados, the pit doesn't have what is necessary to do that. It cannot nourish itself to provide what I desire. It needs help. So here's how I'm gonna help it. What if I put the avocado pit in a bowl of Cheez-Its? Now, this is the moment where everyone is like, oh yeah, the student pastor's preaching this week, right? I put the avocado pit in a bowl of Cheez-Its. Now, there's nothing wrong with Cheez-Its. I love Cheez-Its. I think that they're the perfect road trip snack. I'll go to bat for that. They're great. But the problem is, they're not what's necessary if my goal is for this avocado pit to make another avocado. They're good on their own, but they're not accomplishing. There's one thing that is going to make this a possibility, is going to help me reach my goal, and that's planting the avocado in soil. It's the only way I'm going to make another avocado. See, when it comes to this speaking up, this correcting of false teaching, we are the avocado pit. There's nothing necessarily inherently wrong with us. We have our thoughts, we have our feelings, we have our experiences, and those things are good. But they're not enough on their own, at least when it comes to speaking up against false teaching. And we can surround ourselves with good things. We can read another book. We can listen to that great podcast. You can go to your small group and you guys can talk about it. And those things aren't bad. They are good. But they are not the thing that is going to give nourishment, that is going to help us to speak up. There's only one ground that we can stand on. And that is the word of faith and good doctrine. That is what we put before the brothers and sisters. That is what nourishes the seed. And that is what causes it to grow. And so Paul writes, put these things before the brothers. And these things must be nourished, be trained in the words of faith and the good doctrine that we have followed. See, there's plenty that you could say, but there's not much that you should say when it comes to correcting false teaching outside of that. Now, this is a charge to build a foundation on which we can rest our faith and solidify it. We are to speak the truth. Anything that you have, your thoughts, your feelings, the outside noise, nothing will hold a candle to God's word when it comes to correcting that teaching. Verse 7 continues, have nothing to do with irreverent, silly myths. Rather, train yourself for godliness. For while bodily training is of some value, godliness is of value in every way, as it holds promise for the present life and also for the life to come. Now, this use of the word train is probably what you were thinking of the first time. This is the word where we get our English word, gymnasium. So what do? When you go to a gymnasium? Well, if you're in Harvest Students, you eat candy and scream at one another. But that's not what we're talking about. When you go to a gymnasium, you run, you sweat, you practice, you train. And as an athlete trains for their sport, a good servant trains for godliness. It's a second point. A good servant trains for godliness. Here's a picture of John Bell. John is now officially the campus pastor at our Aurora campus, which I'm very excited about. And you may not know this about John, but he is a marathon machine. John recently finished the Indianapolis Marathon, get this, in 2 hours, 47 minutes, and 44 seconds. That's 6 minutes and 23 seconds per mile for 26.2 miles. Now, I don't know about you, but all 6 minutes and 23 seconds means to me is that's about how long it takes to get from here to Spunky Dunkers if the light is red on Northwest Highway. So in the amount of time that that takes me, John just ran a mile. John is incredibly disciplined in his training, and I had some help from John on this list. Here's how to not train for a marathon. It's how to not train for a marathon. First, look the part, end it there. How insane would it be to buy running shoes, to put on a reflective vest, to eat a bunch of Gatorade shoes, and then sit on the couch? To sign up for the Chicago Marathon, post your registration on Instagram, and then go to brunch instead. See, just because you look like you run marathons does not mean that you run marathons. Second, join the club, don't participate. Now, I could pretty easily sign up for a monthly membership to Lifetime Fitness. And better yet, I could even go to Lifetime Fitness. But if I wake up every morning, put on my gym clothes, drive to Lifetime Fitness, sit in the cafe and drink a smoothie, and then hit the showers, that doesn't mean that I'm training for a marathon. See, you have to participate. Third, no plans, just go for it. That's how to not train for a marathon. It would be incredibly unwise to just start running and assume that at some point I'm gonna reach a marathon. You don't get to a destination if there is no destination. And your body's not ready to run. You can't do that. Pacing is everything. And also, if you just start running, if you complete it, you're gonna be about 30 miles away from your car. Last, have a plan, tell no one. Nobody is more disciplined on their own than if they had accountability. Nobody. You can start strong, you can run a couple times the first 2 weeks, but the moment that your alarm clock goes off, it's pouring the rain and you're supposed to run 10 miles, it's over if you've told no one that you're training. So go ahead, let's look at this list here. These are our four people. Show of hands, who thinks that any of those people are going to successfully run a marathon? Exactly. None of them. Here's another list. Here's how to not train for godliness. Look the part, end it there. See, your post on social media does not mean that you're training for godliness. It's great that you're here, that you have your Bible, that you come regularly, but on its own, that is not training for godliness. It's great to be prepared, but buying the shoes doesn't mean you're training. Join the club, don't participate. How crazy to think that an attendance record or serving in another spot on its own would result in training for godliness. Listen, I love that you're here. I really do. But community is absolutely necessary in training for godliness. It's one thing to be here. It's another thing to be part of what is happening here. You have to participate. No plans, just go for it. Now, I am fully supportive of every person reading Leviticus. I really am. But without any context, without any plan, without a conversation, the book seems pretty confusing. And there's so many people, there's so many groups, there's so many conversations that we would love to have to help you make a plan and push you in that direction in the coming year. And last, have a plan, but tell no one. Again, nobody is more disciplined on their own than if they had accountability. Accountability is the thing that helps you push through when it is difficult. So join a group. Commit to serve. Accountability helps you do the thing that you wanted to do anyway. As you can see, training for godliness takes discipline. It takes serious discipline. I love this definition of discipline. Maybe write this down. Discipline is any activity I can do by direct effort that will eventually enable me to do that which currently I cannot do by direct effort. I cannot squat 500 pounds. I know, hard to believe. I can't though. But if I decided to discipline myself and train, I could make these decisions that would get me to a place where I can squat 500 pounds. And so I want us to talk about a few spiritual disciplines. The spiritual disciplines are not listed somewhere in Scripture, like the fruits of the Spirit or like the Ten Commandments. They're more so derived from the life and tendencies of Jesus Christ, who we model our lives after. And there are many disciplines seen throughout Scripture. I would encourage you to look at all of them. But today we're going to cover four. Four spiritual disciplines. The first is fellowship. Fellowship is gathering together with fellow disciples to participate in a corporate experience with Jesus. Now, your relationship with Jesus Christ is primarily personal, but it is also largely meant to be done in community. See, a single log fire is destined to burn out eventually. But the fire of your faith will only increase in size, in heat, and in impact the more branches you're willing to add on to that fire. If you're not connected in fellowship, 2020 is the year to do so. The second discipline is fasting. Fasting is abstaining from partaking in something, most often food, and a demonstration of our utter dependence on God alone for our sustenance. This discipline was modeled by Jesus. It was continued in the early church, and it was taught about by Jesus Christ in Matthew when he says, "When you fast, do not look gloomy like the hypocrites, for they disfigure their faces that their fasting may be seen by others. Truly I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you fast, anoint your head and wash your face, that your fasting may not be seen by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward you." See, the discipline of fasting is a season of intimacy and privacy as you use the reminders of restraint and physical discomfort to remind you of your utter dependence on the Father and seek the will of the Father. Fasting can be done periodically as a recurring practice, or it can be done as an extended period of time as you prepare for something or seek an answer, seek something from the Lord. Also, fasting is never done alone. Throughout Scripture, people fast and worship. They fast and pray. They fast and mourn. They fast and weep. See, the fasting is a part of something else. The food is not the destination. The goal is not to not eat. The not eating is a vehicle or an avenue that gets us to the goal of intimacy with God the Father. And if you have never practiced this discipline of fasting, I would encourage you to do so in 2020. The third discipline is prayer. Now, to call prayer a discipline is good and it is right, but just to be clear, a prayer life that stands on the shoulders of discipline instead of on the shoulders of relational intimacy with God the Father has the possibility of missing the target. But that being said, prayer is a discipline. It's a discipline that is to be done in private and in public, in victory and defeat, in pain and in pleasure. Prayer is a discipline that is to be done without ceasing. And if prayer is something that you've never practiced regularly, I encourage you right now to write down Matthew 6 and go to Matthew 6 in your time at the beginning of the year. Jesus teaches those listening how to pray. Use that model prayer as an example for you as you begin your prayer life in 2020. Use it as a guide. And if prayer is something that often feels dry, I wanted to encourage you with this. I made a list of what I believe to be the top 10 prayers in the Bible. At least they're my favorite. Go ahead and write these down or get your phones out and take a picture. These prayers, I pray, would be a springboard for you as you read the prayers of people in the Bible and use them in your prayer life. A lot of phones. Let me pose for a picture quick. What do you think? Great. Everyone good? Okay, awesome. The fourth, final discipline is study. Scripture reading and memory is absolutely essential when it comes to engaging with God. Scripture is the food that feeds our faith. And I can tell you from personal experience, there is absolutely nothing, there's no other thing that will provide strength and enduring perseverance for you in faith, like reading and studying the Scriptures. See, how can we do the Word of God if we aren't hearing it in regular study? How can it be profitable for teaching and reproof and correction and training in righteousness if we don't know it? How can the Word be a lamp to your feet and a light to your path if you don't read it? Attempting to live this life in discipleship to Jesus without regular reading and study of His Word would be like showing up to the airport with no plane ticket, no final destination, and no luggage in hand. It would be like trying to shoot a bullseye with no target and no bow to put your arrow in. It would be like trying to win a football game with no coach, no playbook, and no end zones. It just doesn't work. When it comes to discipleship, to being godly, to being a good servant, our study is necessary. That being said, I would encourage every person in this room to read the entire Bible in 2020. It takes about 70 hours to do that. That's 12 minutes per day. And if that seems overwhelming to you, I would recommend that you not look at the weekly screen report on your iPhone. 12 minutes per day is absolutely reasonable. Every person in this room can read the entire Bible in 2020. See, a good servant trains for godliness. And our training is specific and it takes discipline. But if godliness is the goal, according to 1 Timothy 4, our training is absolutely necessary. Back in our Bibles, verse 9 continues. It says, the saying is trustworthy and deserving of full acceptance. For to this end, we toil and strive because we have our hope set on the living God, who is the Savior of all people, especially of those who believe. Last point is a good servant remembers their Savior. A good servant remembers their Savior. Can we all agree that the scripture is right? In this life, we must toil and strive. We grow weary, we get tired, we get discouraged. But the word is true. We have hope. We have hope in a God that is living, a God that is victorious, and a God that is coming back. We have hope in a Savior. And the Bible says in this verse that he's the Savior of all people, especially to those who believe. Now, it's okay to be honest. I'm with you. Was anyone else a little bit confused when you first read that part? You're like, hey, Paul, what? Like, Savior to all people especially? Is there like an extra dose of salvation I can sign up for? Is someone especially saved? It's kind of confusing. This is a picture of Ling Young. Ling worked as part of the New York State Tax Department. She was on the 78th floor of the South Tower of the World Trade Center on September 11th, 2001, when a plane made impact on the building during an attack on our country. When the plane hit, she was knocked unconscious momentarily, and when she awoke, she was unable to see clearly the things around her, and she was unable to stand. This is a picture of Wells Crowther. Wells was a Boston College grad who had moved in 1999 to New York to work as an equities trader. And Wells worked on the 112th floor of the South Tower in the World Trade Center. He was sitting at his desk when a plane made impact. And Wells, after placing a call to his mother, decided to seek safety. But when Wells came across the 78th floor lobby, he saw a large group of people that were in need of help. One of those people was Ling Young. Wells decided to help Ling and a dozen others find safety. They found the only remaining stairwell in the entire building. Wells ushered them down 17 flights of stairs and met firefighters. He left Ling and the dozen others and turned around. And Wells returned to the 78th floor lobby for a second group of people. Wells continued to rescue people up and down those flights of stairs until the South Tower collapsed at 9:59 a.m. Wells' body was found in March of 2002 in the debris alongside of firefighters and emergency workers. See, to all that hear this story, Wells is a hero. He gave his own life. He sacrificed everything to save others. He chose their lives instead of his own. Unanimously, we can agree Wells is a hero. He is. But to Ling Young, that means something different. See, to Ling, his actions are what separated her from life and death, from chaos and danger to safety, protection. Wells changed absolutely everything for Ling Young. To Ling, Wells isn't just a hero. Wells is her hero. And here's the truth. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus is the Savior of the world. Philippians 2 says that every knee will bow on heaven and earth and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. He is the Savior to everyone, but especially to you and to me. See, Jesus is my Savior. Jesus saved me from the sin in which I was so deeply entangled. He stepped in when the only option for me was death, and he gave me life. He rescued me. Jesus changed absolutely everything for me. I was dead. It was over. And then Jesus saved me. And I have to tell you, there is absolutely no better object on which I can set my hope than Jesus Christ. I can set my hope on things that will let me down. I can set my hope on things that will change. I can set my hope on good things. My wife, my job. Maybe for you, your hope rests on your kids. Your hope rests on your money, on your future, on good things. Can I tell you, there's no safer place for our hope than in the faithful arms of Jesus Christ, my Savior and yours. He's the Savior of all, and especially to those who believe. We set our hope on our Savior. 2020 is here. It feels kind of crazy. I don't know if anybody else, like, did you think about the fact that you didn't really know we were going to be alive in 2020? Like, it still kind of sounds like the future when people say it. Well, it's here. This year, whatever year to come, good servants speaking the truth, trained in godliness, and hoping in the Savior. I pray that's who we'll be as a church. I pray that your goal for 2020 is to be a good servant of Christ Jesus. Would you pray with me? God, we love you. We're thankful for Jesus Christ. Our hope is set on Jesus Christ. Thank you for who he is, that he is the Savior and that he is our Savior, that you desire personal relationships with us. Would you help us this year to be good servants of yours? God, help us to speak the truth. Give us endurance and strength when it comes to training ourselves for godliness. Would you go with us, we pray? Would you lead the way? Whatever comes, God, we trust you. Our hope is set on Jesus Christ. Praying that 2020 would be a year where we see more of you. We believe it to be true. In Jesus' name.